What is C++? It is object oriented programming language. Right? What is it? It is having object oriented. What is object oriented programming language? What we have left, that is what we are going to talk about, right? Oops, it is an object oriented programming language or concept. Okay, now why it is named as C++? C was the original language and plus is an enhancement, right? Increment operator. Which increment operator? Is it a post or a pre? Why it is not plus C? Why it is not plus C? Why it is C++? So what is the significance of writing plus after C? So otherwise what would happen? Before the use of C, you have to update it. Right? It is not the case. We are using C as is and adding features to it. So as a result, this is not going to be plus C, but it is going to be C++. So it is nothing but enhancement of C programming language with additional features which suits the programmer to work like the normal object oriented programming skills, or we say related to your real life situations, how we are going to think, look and work like an object. So when I say object, anything which I take it, what is the thing I just consider is an object, is nothing different, right? So anything, if I take a duster, it is an object, right? So if this duster is an object, it will be having its own characteristics. It will be having color, it will be having some dimensions, it will be having some uses, right? So if you take any of the things, it will be considered as an object. What is the definition of object? Anything which you consider, anything, right? So, in the programming concept also, we are thinking of man. We are thinking of any entity which you consider for programming should be considered in the form of object. So, when we think of the object, then we may search around. What is that all? So, what will be the dimension, what are the parameters, what values they will be processing, how they are interlinking with other objects and all. So this particular concept is supposed to be used which suits the real life situations. And as a result, we are going for object oriented programming, which is actually the drawback of C. And as a result, it is an enhancement to C. So C is a procedure oriented language. We are going to see in more details of the procedure oriented and object oriented. But as what is C? C is a object oriented programming language, right? And why it is plus? Because it is an enhancement to C. As a result, it is C++, right? So, as it is a language, what is the speciality of any language? It should follow some syntax, right? So, as being a language, what are the things? It will be having a grammar-like syntax. Then, what are the other things? Only the syntax, enough? It has its own language, it follows its own syntax, and it has its own expressions, it has its own operators, expressions, then it has its own statements, control statements, it has its own reservations, right? So keywords are there. Then there are the reserve words. We'll be having some control statements or control statements are simply the statements which you can write it. Maybe it is for controlling, it may be for without controlling. So it is the statement only. It can be a statement or it can be a control statement, right? So everything as we think of the language, it will be like a normal language, but it can be a very specific programming language. So in the context of programming language, we may see that it follows some syntax, it has some operators and all these things. So one more key area, all this together, what we are calling it as? This language is having a smallest part of this programming language is called what? Anything, any of this entity is called as token. Right? Tokens, we are seeing the tokens. What are the tokens we will be having? Divided into these all categories. There will be identifiers also. Identifiers also. So tokens are identifiers, tokens are literals, right? Tokens are control statements, tokens are operators, tokens are expressions, tokens may be keywords. So any individual smallest individual part of C++ is considered as a token. Smallest entity. It is in the form of either of these things. Right? So, the being a language, it is having its own rules, its own grammar. So, we need to follow those. So, for that say, as it is a programming language, what we are going to do in the programming language, why we are using this language is to program. So, once we do the programming, what is the specification of programming? What for we are doing the programming? What is the purpose of programming? What we do through the programs? What is the basic idea? Why do we do the programs? To solve the problems, right? When you solve the problems, which kind of problems will be tackling? Which kind of problems will be tackling? Yes? What is the type of problems? Logical problems, analytical problems, maybe, yes, relationals, relational problems, all sort of problems we can solve. But for solving those, what we are using? If any problem you are going to solve, what you are thinking of when you are solving? You will be thinking of some logic. You will be thinking of steps. And when you are thinking of the steps, you are organizing it in the form of algorithms and all, right? But at the same time, the program which you are going to write has to be tested with some valid real entities. Maybe those are the values, right? So any program which you do, ultimately requires some inputs, some outputs. So without that, the testing is not going to be complete, fine? So we are writing a program. When you write the program, we actually write a program through the computers for computing purpose. The programs are used for computing something, right? So when we say computing, so what you compute? A data, right? What you are going to compute is a data. And when you compute a data, a device which computes the data is nothing but your computer. So basic idea of having computer is to process the data. That data, how you are feeding, how you are processing, how you are organizing, it is up to you. That depends upon the program which you are going to write, that depends upon the platform which you are using and all these things. But ultimately, we are having a specific value which you are supposed to be tested through the programs is the data. So it is a data processing unit. What we are using a computer is for data processing. So, the very important part of any computing system is the data. And once we have the data, man, come front. You come front here. Sit here. When we think of the data, then come front. When we think of the data, then what all the types we can use it, right? The processing is supposed to be on the data. Then which data is suitable for which situation? And what are all the capabilities of C++ to handle the data? What we are calling it as in the types of data which can be handled by C++, right? That we are seeing. So what are the types? Types of data. What is it called as? data types. So, can you list out first? We have seen, what are the things? What are the categories? Fundamental data types, derived, viva, nahi aaya tha. And what is the third one? User defined data type, right? When I talk about the fundamental data type, so what is there in the fundamental data types? Fundamental data types are those data types which are basic, primitive, which cannot be further divided, right? So there are two categories, or how many categories? What are the categories? How many categories? Yes? Itne hai, Bhagyashri. How many are there? How many categories are there? Fundamental? Sharwari? Yes? Five are there. Are they five? Still we can further divide them and group them. Can we group them, those five? Yes? Alpha, numerical and numericals. Numeric, alphanumeric. Can be divided? It can be? Yes? Numeric comes under alphanumeric. Yes, Ashit? Okay, numeric comes under the alphanumeric. There is no, or numeric comes under alphanumeric. Why do we have? Actually, we are having alphanumeric. Generic. We are having this alphanumeric and generic. Or in some cases, we simply say numeric. Under the numeric, we are having alphanumeric and numeric. Under numeric, it is say, you can say numbers only. In that sense, I am talking about alphanumeric and numeric. And in generic, there is only one, that is five. Now, in case of alphanumeric, what is the alphanumeric we are having? It is only char. And under numeric, eight. Float double, right? So we have not seen last year this, but these are the categories which we can talk about. What we did as last year, under the fundamentals we are listed char, int, float, double and void. Why I am now listing it in the different way? Because the numeric data type, all the alphabets are stored in the form of ASCII values, and ASCII values are nothing but numbers. So there is only one basic category, number. But numbers again subdivided into characters, numbers again subdivided into the precision values like float and seven. So as a result, these three categories are possible. Right? So we may remember the last year like five, or we may remember this. Both are correct. So either of that you can use. So alphanumerical values are character, int, float and double. Alphanumerical is only character, numerical is int, float and double. Okay? Fundamental data types are in short five. Char, int, float, double and void. Why it is generic? Why we are saying it generic? We are not used. What is the purpose of using void? What is the void use? Last year we used void. Where we are used? In the functions, right? So the meaning is the void in what sense we are taking? no data type. Right? Does not return anything means what? It is not having any data type. So this generic term basically used for creating the templates. In future, when you are going to see the classes, and we don't know at present which data type is going to be fit for. So in that sense, we are using void, and that can be replaced with the specific data what is being processed. So accordingly, the templates will be created by using void. As such, void is used for nothing. What we are saying presently, the void is not related to any data type. So when we say no data type, we can use the term void. Okay. Now, under this fundamental data types, why this numerical data is again subdivided and what are the sizes? So how many bytes are reserved by each of them? Carry is 1. So carry is 1 byte. Int is 2 byte. Float is 4 byte. It is 8 byte. But sometimes you have seen that these byte size is insufficient to hold the values. So what we are using in that sense? So what are those called? Long, short, sign, unsigned? They are the type modifiers, right? So these modifiers help us to enhance the size or reduce the size. So what are those type modifiers? Long is one, opposite to this is short, then signed and unsigned. Unsigned, by default, what is the value for everyone? If I declare any variable, by default it takes the modifier as signed. It is not going to have unsigned, right? So signed, unsigned. Signed is that which holds the sign plus minus and so on. So unsigned, what is the use of unsigned? When to use unsigned? In case you require only absolute value. Right? So in that case, we can use unsigned. I think last paper, you are having one question on unsigned. Right? So unsigned is used in such a context that where absolute value should be used. So what is the advantage of signed and unsigned? Is when we are using the sign, it is reserving 1 bit of space to hold. Whereas unsigned frees that particular bit. So it enhances the size by 1 bit. That is the advantage of using unsigned. Okay. So, one char, one byte is going to hold how many total characters? 255. Why it is 255? It reserves 1 byte. What is the meaning of reserving 1 byte? What is the meaning of reserving 1 byte? We are having the space of 1 byte means total 8 bits. Right? So all 1, 1, 1, 8 times. Right? So this will be 2 raised to 0 to 2 raised to 7. So 1 into 2 raised to 7 plus 1 into 2 raised to 6 plus 1 into 2 raised to 5, 2 raised to 3, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. If you add all those, then what the value, decimal value you are getting, that is the maximum size which we can hold in 1 byte space. So as a result, the value which you are getting is 255, and this is the value which we are using it for having the character sets. What are those character sets we are having? ASCII values. We see the bytes reserved for storing the ASCII values of any alphabet is ASCII reserving 1 byte of space. So it means there are 255 codes corresponding to 255 characters. We can process any of the character by using its code. What is its code? Is ASCII code. There are coding standards. We are seeing the different coding standards. That may be a standard which you are using is ASCII, maybe ISCII, or maybe Unicode, or maybe BCD code, maybe EBCDIC code. So it depends upon what coding standards we are using. But for personal computers and we can say small range computers, we are using the ASCII coding system. So as a result, we restrict ourselves to have one character space which will be processing at the most to 55 characters, right? So any value which you can set should be from 0 to 255. It may belongs to only one character. So in a similar way, if I go for int, what is the limitation I am having the byte size? It will be having 2 bytes, means total 16 bits. So if it is having 16 bits, then again it will be having the limitation of how much? Nisar, how much you can keep it in 2 bytes? Kitna? Nihar? 32,000? 32,000? 6-7 or 7? 32,760 something. So you have to calculate it. So it is approximately 32,600 something is coming. So you have to calculate it. It means if any value 32,600, and I will be writing a random number. So it is more than 32,000. So if it is going to be like this, then any number in case of your factorial calculations, you have seen that when it crosses the limit of 32, it starts negating. You will be getting the negative values, right? So we have to ensure that your values for 2 byte size should not cross the limit of 32,000. So once it goes beyond, then because the values are going to be, what is this? Actually 2 bytes, it is reserving 2 bytes for signed and unsigned both, right? So it is the maximum signed number, signed integer, which can be held in this. And what is the minimum signed integer can be held? In the negation. So minus 32,676.77. Right? Because what is the range we are having? Minus 32,000 to plus 32,000. That is the range we are having. Right? From negative to positive. These many values we can store. So if it reaches to this, then it will start from 0 again. It will come to the minimum level. So you may see some values in the negation if you cross the limit of it. So to enhance this limit, what we are using? We are using long. So what the long will do? It will add 2 bytes to the existing space. So we are having in 2, it will add 2 bytes to it. So total size becomes now 4 bytes. So 4 bytes will be enough to hold more than this value. So we have to calculate what is the exact value which you will be getting for 4 byte, right? So similarly, we may go for float and double. So float is having, why it is the difference in float and double? Only the precision values which you are going to use. 4 byte will be having less precision value when we compare with the 8 byte. So it is double of it. So if I say double, long of float, what will happen? I will be adding long of float is what? Is it going to be double? It is going to be 6 bytes. It adds only 2 bytes to the existing. So long float is going to give you 6 byte space, and long double will give you 10 bytes of space, right? So based on these parameters, you can understand the limitations of processing the values. Always you can find out, is that particular variable is sufficient to hold the value which you are going to process. If it is not, you can enhance the size by using the modifiers. Fine? Then, we come across the other data types now. What are the other data types? These are all the fundamental data types. What are the other data types? Derived and what are the derived data types we have thought of? Arrays, good. What is the second category? Pointers. Then, or only two? Arrays, pointers, functions. and structure is not there. Functions are derived data types. They are not user defined. You are not defining the data type of the function. Are you defining the data type? No. So the function will act as a module, and that module is user defined module. But its data type is derived form of the existing data types. So functions, then reference, as such we can say pointer or reference. We are using reference operator. We use the reference operators. So they are pointers or references, arrays, functions. These are few of the derived data types. Why it is derived data type? They uses the fundamental data types and they are acting differently by using the fundamental concepts. Like arrays, it is going to be group of similar elements clubbed under one head, can be processed as a group, right? The pointers or the references, what we do is the references, we are not going to the pointers, but we are going to the references. What is reference? What is the reference? It creates an alias. Is it record or restore the values, but the original values are there, or will it change? It changes. It is creating an alias to the existing location, right? It is a new name given to the whom? To the existing variable. So it is an alias, right? So it is not using any other memory location other than what it is having before. So it is referring to, so it is named as reference. In the similar way, the pointers are also doing the same thing. So what the pointers are doing, they are taking the address of the location and they are working on the address. So we'll go in deep of pointers afterwards. So pointers are similar to the reference, except that their existence is independent, where references existence is dependent on the original values. So I am referring to some location, right? That is the reference. So I am not existing unless that reference is existing. But I am a pointer. If I am a pointer, then I may keep the address of any location, or I may not have any address to keep. It is like my address diary. My diary may be empty if I am not pointing to. If I am pointing to, I will be having that address, through whom I can go through and modify it. So pointers are something refers to the addresses, and references are something which creates an alias and refers to those. It is only applicable if they are existing, otherwise not. Right? So that is the difference between these two things. The functions is the another category which you are going to have related to the derived data types. Why it is the function? When we write the function, for example, I write int add int x comma y. So this is one of the functions. Now see, this is nothing but if I write int x, will it be similar to this? Add int x int y is something like a variable and it is a data type. But this data type now is doing more than what it is before. What it is doing? It is adding these two variables and giving the result. So what is the routine we have written under this? That has been done as a task by this function and gives me the return value. So it is a derived form of the normal variable. So in functions, you see, you are using your while, you are using your double, you are using some data types whichever are required. So all these data types, whatever we are using, they are doing something extra than the normal, and as a result they are derived from of the existing fundamentals, right? So the functions are derived data types because they are deriving something extra than the normal data types. Okay, so arrays, pointers, reference, functions, these are the derived data types. There is no limit, like 2 bytes, 1 bytes or something, which we have seen in the case of this. But here, there is no limit. Why it is not? Because they are derived, they may change with the situation. I don't know how many values I am going to process in the RA. So at runtime I may decide, or at the time of particular example I may decide how many students data I can refer to, right? So these are all not having any fixed value of the storage. Okay, then the third category is user defined data type. So we have completed actually this part and this part, this part. So we are left with this in the derived pointers, and we are having in the user defined data types. What are the user defined data types we are having? Very first one we have seen as a structure. What is the second one? Second one is class. Third one is enumeration or enum. Fourth one is, one more I told you, can you recall that? Fourth one is union, right? So structure, class, enum, union, these are the four derived data types which we are going to focus this year. All this we are going to do. Now why it is user defined data types? It is, the problem with the built in data type is that it is having some limitations which cannot be used. So to enhance some capabilities of them, we have gone through the derived data types, but still they are having some limitations again, and those limitations will be overcome in using user defined data types. Now structure, class, enum and union, out of this, structure we are covered, classes we are going to cover, enumeration, union is a big part, I will be giving just introduction to the union, but as such union is not there, it is same as the structure, so as a result it is not been there in the syllabus, but I can give you the differences of all. So structure, we are supposed to make the layout of particular entity in the form of its data, what you are going to use above. So if we are see the complex number structure, what we do in the complex number? When I say a complex number, immediately we are getting its characteristics. A complex number must have real and imaginary part. So those numbers are the part of the complex structure. So we are included those parts. Now in addition to that, we can think of beyond. Now which are all the possible operations one can perform on the complex numbers? Maybe the addition of two complex numbers, maybe subtraction or any other operations which you can perform. Those operations can be the part of the functions. So if I club these functions and structures together, then it will become a class. And once I say this as a my class, then maybe a complex number 1 may be added with the complex number 2. So